He's bigger than you are, too.
Yeah, he most everybody's bigger than me.
Yeah, yes. Ma'am, can you tell me your name and how you spell it, please?
My name is Evelyn Stone, E-V-E-L-Y-N-S-T-O-N-E.
Evelyn, where are we at? Wait, what city are we in?
We're in Griffin, Indiana.
Beautiful. All right, mic check's fine. Lighting's good. We're rolling.
Okay. Evelyn, I'm just going to ask you some questions. We're just going to talk. All right, no right, wrong. Don't worry about the camera or anything. But I understand that, first of all, tell me how old you are, if you don't mind. If you tell me how old you are and how long you've lived here in Griffin.
I'm 87 years old, will be 88 in July, and my parents and all my siblings, not all of them, but some was born later, moved here in about 1920, somewhere along there. It's in the 20s.
Okay. Now, when the tornado came, March 18th, 1925. Tell me about yourself then. How old were you? What were you doing? Tell me about Evelyn back in March of 1925.
Well, there's not much to tell. I went to school across from the street from us where we lived and came home and we had chores to do. And then we just had our regular meals and sat around. We did have a radio, so we listened to Amos and Andy and stuff like that, you know, and just regular life.
Okay. The day that the tornado came, March 18th, can you remember what it was like outside that day? Can you remember what kind of a day?
It was balmy. I didn't know what the word meant, but after I was told that that's what they called it, it was balmy. It wasn't hot and it wasn't cold. Of course, this is March, you know. And the day seemed okay till about 4 o'clock, and then it began to cloud up. And that's when my mother decided that she should get her laundry in. So me and my youngest sister helped her get it in. We didn't get it all in because some of it was found down in this end of town later on. But we got it in. And then, as I said in that paper, she got in the house and she hollered for my oldest sister to get the baby out of the window. When she did, it blew right out. It didn't hurt anybody. But my mother, the door fell in on her when she's trying to shut it and hurt her head, but wasn't anything bad. And then the house was turned around with us in it. It's facing the north when it was built, and when it settled down, it was facing the east and us in it.
Do you remember?
Yes, it was a big roaring. I remember that, yes. It roared, yes. Just like a train. That's why ever since, a lot of times after that, a lot of us kids would, when the train come through town, we'd kind of get scared, you know.
It roared. Do you remember, did you have a chance to see the sky? Did you look at the sky at that time?
Well, we didn't know enough to look at it. You know, didn't know what was taking place. It's just like a new adventure to us, I suppose.
You had no warning that this was...
No, nothing.
Because this tornado had been on the ground.
It started in someplace in Missouri, didn't it?
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes. And so, it was your mom, or was there... It started to cloud up. And so, somebody knew to start running and to get to a safe place, right?
Well, I really don't know whether they did or not, because there was several killed, you know. But we didn't know that we had any place to go, you know. We just didn't realize that you could go to a basement or someplace. Of course, the kids that was left in the school, they weren't safe either. But they had a basement to go to, and they didn't know to go to it, I don't guess. But we just didn't know what to do.
Tell me about your father.
Well, he was a hard-working man, and I'm proud of him because he was born in Illinois, around Harrisburg and over in there, Benton. And when he was 18 years old and graduated out of high school, they offered him a teaching job. And he wouldn't take it. He said, no, I want to be a farmer. So that's what he was.
Okay. And the day of the tornado, what happened with your father?
Well, he was down here and working in the filling station. See, it hadn't, the crop time hadn't started yet. It was in March and it hadn't started yet. So he was working extra in the filling station. It belonged to somebody else. And he was there by himself. There wasn't nobody else in there with him. And he was standing at the front door. And of course the front fell in on him. And that's when he got hurt. And we didn't know anything about it for 3 days later, where he was or anything.
Evelyn, tell me about what happened right after the tornado. After everything came through and your house turned around, what do you remember about what happened after that?
Well, I don't know for sure whether somebody came by after us or not, but we were still in the house. And I remember walking from our house to this house up here on the corner. And it wasn't all intact, but the basement was not hurt. It was intact, every bit of it. And they took us there. And on the way there, it rained, it poured, and then it hailed. And we just got there just before it started hailing. And we was there for a while. I don't know how long. See, time back then, to my memory, doesn't mean too much because I was too young to just really remember that. And we was taken out in the country to a big farmhouse that wasn't hurt. That's the way the storm did, you know, just hit places. And I don't know how long we were there, but I realized when I walked in the door in the hallway, there laid a baby on the table, and it had a blanket around it, and they told me later that it died, but I don't know who the baby was. And I don't know how long we were there, but my uncle from Poseyville finally came and got us and took us to his house out north of Poseyville. And that's when we found out where my dad was, because he got to the Red Cross, you know, and asked him. And I don't know how long my dad was in the hospital, but he finally came out there. And then, is that enough? You want me to go on?
No, that's fine. I'm curious, because you were seven. Uh-huh. It must have been a shocking experience at 7 years old to know that, 67 people in your town mm-hmm. were, how did they explain that to you? How did you, what?
I don't know, really. I learned it in different times, you know, who had died and how and everything like that. I know that this lady that's in the nursing home, she had a brother that was up here in a store, grocery store, and him and the grocery store owner's boy was there, and it caught a fire, and they couldn't get out. And I was told that they screamed and hollered and save me, save me. Nobody could get to them, so they died. And that's what sticks in my mind most. When I know the bad cloud or storm's coming up, I almost get frantic.
That's understandable. What about friends? Did you have friends who were in the school who didn't make it?
I don't remember if there was anybody killed in the right at the school or not, but I'm pretty sure out this way in the country, some children had just got home from school, and one of the boys was killed there. I remember that, them telling me that. But I don't remember any of them killed in the school. They were pretty well protected if they could get, you know, someplace. But this lady that I'm talking about was upstairs. And as she came down the stairs, a piece of brick hit her in the back of the head. But I don't think she ever went to the hospital. It cured that by herself. Back then, you know, a lot of people cured everything themselves. But it didn't hurt her in any way.
When you came back from the house in the country, it was your uncle's house, mm-hmm. right? When you came back here to the town that you knew, Griffin, mm-hmm. what did it look like? What was the impression you got when you saw what had happened after the storm?
Well, I just didn't think it'd ever be the same. Just didn't see how it could be, because there, to my knowledge, there wasn't any rich people here. They might have been some well off, but not really rich, you know, where they could just dive in and maybe help somebody, the ones that needed it the most. But the Red Cross did a lot of help. We had blankets given to us and food and the necessary things, you know. But to me, it just, well, it looked disastrous. That's all there was to it.
After the years have gone on, you've probably told this story a few times anyway to family and friends and mm-hmm. so on. If you could, and you sort of summed this up here, but if you could, what kind of an impact on your life would you say that this was, that this event was a major impact on your life? Did it, what kind of an impression did it leave on you for the rest of your life?
Well, I would say it left a pretty big one, because my second husband was transferred to Oklahoma in 1958, and I'd always heard Oklahoma was the worst place on earth for tornadoes. And I was a little bit skeptic, but I followed him. And every time they would come on the radio or television talking about a tornado headed our way, I'd break out in hives. And it would just, well, it just scared me to death. That's all it was to it. But we did have a storm cellar out there, but that eased it a little bit.
The rebuilding of Griffin after the storm, did everybody say, or do you remember people saying, well, we're getting out of here, we're moving somewhere else, or did people say?
Some of them did, yeah, some of them went, especially a lot of the younger ones. You know, I don't mean real young, but in their 20s and 30s, they did leave, yes. But they always like to come back. Yeah. We have an alumni banquet every year, and there's a lot of, oh, they come from California and Florida and a lot of places to be back here.
Out of all the people you're aware of, how many people are alive today that you know of who experienced that tornado that day?
Just three here. Me and Bob Nessler and Mildred Hancock down at the nursing home. Now that's all I know. Somebody that is in with the Lumna Banquet could tell you more about that.
Mm-hmm. How does it feel? What is your reaction when I say to you that you survived the worst tornado in American history?
Well, I guess it's something to think about. And it's good to be here. Of course, our world is in a terrible situation right now, but that's to be expected, I guess, with such a big population and everything. But I try to make the best of it.
What about the community? You mentioned about people getting together and so on. What about, was there a, tell me about the community in cleaning up.
I don't remember much too much about that, but they did build a large gymnasium here where that, like I said, where that back is. And that's where we had church, with all of our meetings there, you know, and just everybody just got together. We were a close community, and we still are today.
Was there any, do you recall, any sort of concern that, because this is Midwest, and I grew up in a town like this, what was the reaction of the church people, the religious people? Was there a religious reaction to this?
Well, now, I was awfully young to remember too much about that, but I'd always gone on to church all my life. Even when my parents didn't live here, we were always a church-going family, and I do remember that. But as far as, there was a Baptist church and a Methodist church. And as far as them, they wasn't rivals or anything like that. They just didn't mix, I guess you'd say it. You know, they had their own way.
Okay. I guess what I want to say is, was there a, did people suddenly become more church-going after this?
Well, they probably did. I think they did after 9/11, don't you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I do.
Yes, they probably did.
Out of all of this that occurred, and you wrote two pages, one on each side. Mm-hmm. But let's say that you have to put that down to a paragraph or so. In your words, what would you describe as the most memorable or impressionable part about this tornado that hit in 1925? What stands out to you the most?
Well, I really think it's because none of my family was hurt bad. And getting our dad back and our house back on the foundation and getting back to life again like we had been. Is that what you wanted to hear?
Yes. Well, it's your show. You can say whatever you want. Okay. These days, let me ask you this. Do you believe that if this had happened last year, what's the difference between now with communication and what happened in 19?
Oh, we'd have known it way ahead of time. Yes. Yes, the TV is real good about it. Even the radio, if you don't have a TV. Yeah.
Because some of the accounts I've heard is that this was a huge tornado.
Oh, it was, yes.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever talk to anybody who actually saw it or described what it was like?
No, I didn't really. I've heard, like I said, I've heard different things over the years, but just to sit down and ask somebody questions, I haven't.
Okay. What have you heard?
Well, I heard one person say that they seen a mule flying through the air with the 2x4 through it. Now, believe it or not, that's one of them things, you know. And then up in the other end of town, we always call it the other end because the railroad.
...45 to 85 in one day.
As long as my air conditioner keeps running. That's all I care.
I do.
Here,
okay. You're rolling?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I want to hear this again. You talked to... We have the mules. We had that, right?
No, I think it cut off right before the mule part.
So oh, okay. Well, yeah. Tell me again, Evelyn. I want to hear these stories about what you heard. What are some of the stories you've heard?
Well, like I said, I heard that someone seen a mule flying through the air with the 2x4 in it. I didn't see it, of course. And then up here in the other end of town, they was... a couple of trees not too far apart, and they said that there was a board in between them, had got in between them and spread them apart. Now, I did see that years later because they kept it in there a long time. The tree, I think one of them or maybe both of them finally rotted. But I did see that.
Is there any story, you mentioned the baby, mm-hmm. and I don't want to bring back a whole lot of bad memories for you, but is there any story that you heard or a family you heard of that after the storm you thought, oh, that's just, what's the worst, most heart-wrenching thing you heard of?
Well, I really think it's those two boys that got burned up in that grocery store, because one of them was one of my dear friend's brother, and he's buried up there on the hill.
On the other side of that, were there any miracles other than your family? Because you guys, you
yeah, we were lucky.
It,
but, we were lucky.
But how about others? Were there any miracles that came from this?
I really couldn't tell you. Somebody older than me probably could. But.
Okay. Is there anything that you, because I looked through, I think we touched on most of this. Is there anything that I haven't asked you that, as a person who is, could leave, you're going to leave your story, all right? It's one of these days, we're going to look back, and we're going to look for stories about the tri-state tornado, mm-hmm. the great tornado. If you could say something or leave somebody with an idea.
Just let it ring.
You sure?
Yeah. It's not important.
Okay. What is it you would... Oh, thank you. Yeah, I'll let that... It's probably a salesman. They want to...
Oh, yeah.
They're saying, Evelyn, why is that...
Telemarketing.
Television... Why is that television
that's,
over there?
That's sure. probably right.
Yeah.
She's the only one knows over here.
Oh, is that right? All right. I'll let that stop. Right. Mm-hmm. Persistent.
My answering machine doesn't work.
Oh. Mine doesn't either. Mine doesn't either.
I guess they're not going to get tired, are they?
You want to bring the phone over to you?
You'll probably quit ringing the time you get there. Yeah, it has.
Yeah, okay. All right. If, after all of this, if 50 years from now, or whatever, as a person who...
I won't be here. Then.
Well, I won't either. I won't either. I better not be. 50 years from now, somebody comes along and reads that Griffin, Indiana was pretty much flattened. But there was somebody who lived there at the time. If you could tell people, what is it you would want them to know about the town and how it came through this tornado?
Well, like I said, it was a pretty close-knit town. And we all had a lot of fun all the time. We had basketball games. We had tournaments. We had picnics. We had church revivals and just everything that a small town would have. And I've always enjoyed living here.
Okay.
And I still have a lot of friends today.
I'll bet you do. I'll bet you do.
Yeah, I'm in a card game. We play cards, four of us.
Gamble? Do you gamble?
No. We just play canasta.
Oh, okay.
No. People my age don't gamble. They gamble if they get up at bed that morning at bed, out of bed.
Anything that I haven't asked you that you wanted to say about the tornado or the storm or anything that you recall that we haven't talked about?
Well, it's just something that if I've got very many years left, I don't want to go through it again. That's for sure. Because I remember too much of it already. And some of my friends will sort of, they don't exactly laugh, they kind of snicker when a bad wind comes up or a bad cloud, and I get kind of antsy. They think it's kind of funny. Well, they haven't been in a tornado, and that's what I tell them. I said, if you're ever in one, I said, you'll change your mind.
That's excellent.
Okay.
Anything else, Blaine?
No.
Because I grew up in Peru, Indiana. So that's the schoolhouse there, right?
That's what's left of it. See, it had an upstairs.
Yeah.
It's all gone.
Actually,
my mother didn't even know. if she had ever heard of them, she never talked about it.
Right. Gosh. Well, this is not a, I mean, you know, they...
Well, when we got there, somebody told us there'd been a light tornado at Holdenville.
Yeah.
And so we thought, well, we're probably next. We lived, went to where we woke up as the middle right. part of Oklahoma. And then one time when we had to go to the cellar, we heard later that a town just about 15 miles from us, they had a bad tornado and yeah. the whole family was killed, even some of their livestock.
Yeah.
So we just called it a root cellar. You know, we didn't think about it having to go in it for protection.
Yeah.
Later on, my baby sister fell down in it.
Oh, really? Is she okay?
Yeah, she's okay. She's when he was quiet too, but he took an ocean one day. He wanted to get rid of his dog, so he threw him down an old-fashioned toilet hole.
Oh my!
We made him get him out too. He put a rake down in there and said, "Now that you got to get that dog on that rake and get him up here." And you had to give him a bath.
Yeah. That was out at the old outhouse, right?
A privy.
Yeah. Two-seater.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what my grandparents had. Was you know.
I don't guess there's any of them nowadays. There's none here, I know.
Yeah. Well, they're you see them around every now and then, but the thing is, they
to this other house, and they raised it, you know, and they had a double toilet out there, but it was all enclosed, you know. It was there for years and years and years after they quit having church.
Yeah,
and finally it just. The outside just finally started falling, you know, and they got rid of it.
Yeah.
But see, we had telephones.
Yeah. Yeah, I was wondering if you would, because 1925, there wasn't a lot of...
You mentioned electricity a while ago. I really don't remember whether we had electricity or not. I know we didn't have an indoor bathroom.
Right.
I do know that.
Yeah. Yeah. School. And they didn't have electricity until they came in to town. And my grandfather, her father, and great-grandpa were barn builders.
Oh.
And so, you know, and carpenters and things like that.
Were they, what do they call those people up there in that part that goes around and builds?
Oh, Amish?
Yeah.
The same strictness and procedure, and it was... My dad was a kid. The men sat on one side, the women on the other.
That's the way they did over here at this Baptist church.
Yeah.
They didn't have any musical
instruments. Nope. And the women always wore a little prayer hat, a little
something on their
skull cap,